I don't know why brethren have given up the historical and the grammatical position on the phrase only begotten, on the force monogenes, to adopt what is at best a dubious and nebulous idea. There's nothing gained in it, from what I see. The AD 70 people, that is the AD 70 heretics, would like that. So in fact, one of them, Don Preston, has made the argument that in trying to use Acts 13, verse 33, to try to prove that Jesus was born again. Now think about that. That the resurrection from the dead was, in effect, his new birth. Well, that's right out of Herbert W. Armstrong and Ted Armstrong nonsense. Acts 13, 33 concerns the birth of Christ. Just as Acts chapter 3 concerns the birth of Christ. It's used, the verb, form of the verb is used two times. That's translated, raised up. Christ was to be raised up. It's talking about, and he was, according to the Apostle Peter in his sermon in Acts 3. It's talking about his first coming, not AD 70, not his resurrection from the dead or anything else. It's talking about his birth. And it was then he was declared to be the only begotten. Second, in John chapter 3, have you noticed verse 16 uses monogenes? And of course, it's a compound word, two words, mono or mana, and gana'o. Do you know that gana'o appears in verse 3 and verse 5 relative to the new birth, and it's translated born? Why do we translate it born, to be born again, born anew, verse 3, and then verse 5, to be born again, born of the water and of the Spirit, that phrase, and yet we get down verse 16 and we cannot translate gana'o, which appears in the compound word, born or begotten? Why suddenly do we throw it out? That just doesn't make sense. But grammatically, and again, and he laid out the case historically, the translation ought to be only begotten. Brethren dropped the ball on this about the time of the death, the untimely death of Noel Meredith. That sort of disappeared from the scene. Brother Noel Meredith, and for that matter, Robert Taylor, was doing some good writing on the subject, and Brother Taylor sort of disappeared from the scene shortly after that, as far as the defense of the historic position. At any event, are there any comments that anyone would like to make pertaining to that matter? Brother Talbot, I greatly appreciate your defense of this. And I read Brother Clifford's letters, and quite frankly, I considered them rather rude and presumptive. Amen. That he considered himself to be such a scholar that you ought to keep quiet. I mean, that's how it came across to me. Rather than let us discuss this thing reasonably and properly as brethren ought to. Any other comments that anyone would like to make? All right, I guess you're satisfied with it. We have a couple of questions, several that have been turned in. Along this line, this is in connection with that, a question was brought to my attention relative to the meaning of the word spirit in John chapter 3, verse 5. Evidently, there are some that are saying the spirit there is the human spirit. And this is right out of the Dan Billingsley nonsense that is trying to take the gospel accounts and make them part of Old Testament legislation. The argument is being made that when Jesus said that you're to be born of water and of the Spirit, that he's talking about the human spirit, and that was something that Nicodemus was to do right then and there, thus does not apply to the gospel age. Does not apply after that. And yet there are numerous passages that speak of the new birth after Pentecost, such as Titus chapter 3, verse 5, speaks of the new birth, being born of the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Spirit. James 1, verse 18, of his own will begat he us by the word of truth. 1 Corinthians 4, 15, the Apostle Paul said, I have begotten you by the gospel. And by the way, if Paul, that could be said of Paul, it could also be said of the Holy Spirit who inspired Paul. 1 Peter 1, verse 23, we're born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible by the word of God that liveth and abideth forever. And so the new birth is spoken of in the New Testament era. Ephesians 5, we're cleansed and sanctified by the washing of, with the washing of water by the word. Ephesians 5, 25 and 26. I don't know why this position has come up other than it is seems to be part of the Dan Billingsley heresy, and they're trying to remove the new birth from the New Testament. We have any comments? In fact, here's a statement. I'm not going to give the name of the writer for right now, but it's a woman. She said, taken in context, Jesus was speaking to Nicodemus, a Pharisee. If Holy Spirit was meant by Spirit, Nicodemus could not obey the command since the Spirit was not available to anyone until after Jesus' ascension. Now think about that. John 16, 7. Is the passage she cites. Well, in the sense that Jesus uses the phrase, uses the expression, that would be so, but she assumes or makes a false assumption. Keep in mind, John the Baptist preached. He was a prophet of God, was he not? Well, how did he prophesy? He was filled with the Spirit from his mother's womb, Luke chapter 1, verse 15. So the Spirit was living and active during that period of time, was instructing people through the preaching of John. Also, Christ had the Holy Spirit without measure, and we're talking about the degree of miraculous power and so on. He had the Spirit to the nth degree, so to speak. John 3, verse 34. Her statement is just very presumptuous and assumes something she can't prove. In fact, the scripture is totally set against it. But she goes on to say, Jesus is referring to the prophecy of Ezekiel 36, 26 and 27. My spirit in Ezekiel 36, 27 refers to a mindset or disposition, a change of heart that would cause them to walk in his statutes. The new statute that was given was John's baptism. Again, I believe she misuses Ezekiel 36, 27. Born of water was a reference to John's baptism. Born of spirit meant a change in heart. We know from Matthew 21, 23, 27 that the Pharisees did not believe John. Therefore, they were not baptized by him. Jesus was giving Nicodemus a command to obey in that moment, We know that later he was secretly a follower. John 19, verse 39. Again, I believe in just trying to read the Spirit out of the passage, she makes a huge leap that just won't hold up. Keep in mind that those that were baptized under John's baptism were entering into the preparatory material that made up the kingdom. They became part of the church ultimately and officially on the day of Pentecost, when those who obeyed the gospel on that day were brought together with them, according to Acts chapter 2, verse 41. Proof that they were entering the church. Take, for example, Luke chapter 16:16, where Jesus said that there were those who were pressing into the kingdom. Matthew chapter 23, verse 13. He says that though they were entering in, and of course the Pharisees were trying to stop them or were throwing up roadblocks to try to keep them from entering the kingdom. Well, the implication is they were at least trying to enter the kingdom, at the very least, and that is prior to the day of Pentecost. The work of John the Baptist was preparatory to the establishment, and he was gathering the material and bringing together those things that eventually Christ would use in building his kingdom, his church. Matthew 16, 18 and 19. We have any comments concerning this? Any observations, questions, follow up? Yes. Up here. And by the way, this woman, we've had it out with her on a couple of other occasions concerning divorce and remarriage. And she teaches the Billingsley. That's why I say that this is the Billingsley doctrine.
I'm Jerry Brewer, Daniel.
And I'm from Elk City, Oklahoma, 115 miles west of Oklahoma City on Interstate 40. For the Muslims who want to find me. I had a question on the state. She made the statement something about Jesus said he Nicodemus had to do this right then.
Is that right then?
Okay,
that's what she asserted.
Right then.
Yeah,
Jesus wasn't talking about what she had to do then. Mm-hmm. That has nothing to do with what you. He's speaking in figurative language. If he had right then, he would have said, you need to be baptized.
Mm-hmm.
She's wrong. He's looking forward. Mm-hmm. You want to get in the kingdom? You've come to me. Jesus knew why he'd come. You've come to me to want to know how to get in the kingdom. Well, what you got to do? If you want to be in the kingdom, you got to be born again.
Most certainly.
Well, when is that? Well, when the kingdom gets here.
Yeah. But even in preparation the kingdom, they were having to be baptized. Asophos and hamartion for the remission of sins.
Yes, they had to for the remission of sin under John's baptism. Mm-hmm. But I think she makes a big leap there.
Well, she makes several.
So, anyway.
But that's not unusual.
Yeah. Well, that's my observation.
Okay, thank you. Any other observations, questions?
You want me to go
ahead? On this, yes. Or what? Yes, he has a comment.
Danny Douglas, Central Church of Christ, Mount Pleasant, Tennessee. I agree with Brother Dunham. I appreciate Brother Tarbert and the material that he presented yesterday and the book that he's done. And I was thinking yesterday that we have a lot of brethren now that are catching on to the English Standard Version. And my concern is on that one, I looked all the passages, the only begotten Son in John 1, verse 14 and 18, John 3, verse 16 and 18, 1 John 4, 9, in the English Standard, they do not translate monogenes. They refer to Jesus Christ as God's only Son. And also in Hebrews 11, 17, the significance there of Isaac being the only begotten of Abraham, which is very crucial application there, as well as the others, that this version that is considered by some to be so outstanding mistranslates monogenes. And that was the only thing, and Brother Denham may want to say something about that. Thank you.
As a follow-up on that point, the English Standard Version ostensibly was to be a word-for-word translation, and the translators are to be commended for that intent. But there are times that their theology still came through, rather than a literal translation. Matthew chapter 5, verse 17 and 18, if I recall, is a passage that clearly they sought to leave the impression that the law of Moses is still in effect. And the translation is quite problematic there. It just is not a good rendering. And if you take that passage and then place it up against Ephesians 2 and Colossians 2, where the law was nailed to the cross and so on, you've got a direct contradiction in these renderings. When it comes to word-for-word translations, and of course that should be the key. That should be the standard. Now, why? Jesus himself, quoting the Old Testament, said it stands written. That's the force of the verb. It stands written. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And by the way, that's why we should translate it monogenes as only begotten. That's translating the whole word, not just a part of it and ignoring the rest. But we're to abide by every word. Word for word translation is the best. And the other, which is dynamic equivalence, leaves too much up to the translator to explain it according to his perception. And that perception oftentimes is flawed. And we need to be careful. The best word for word translations are still the King James and the American Standard. Behind them, the New King James. And there are some other older versions, some that even predated the King James, that are good translations. But there has not really been a good literal word for word that doesn't have some serious flaws in it since the New King James. The New King James, and there are aspects of it I don't like, but at least it is a safe translation. If you've got to have a modern version because your English is so stunted, or your knowledge of English syntax and wording and so on needs some help, get the New King James. And I don't want to be cruel about it. I don't want to be, you know. But yeah. My children, when you have a 40-year-old man says, I cannot understand the King James Version or the American Standard Version. My children learn to read the King James Version. And this, brethren, it says something about our own educational attainments. When an individual... And in some cases, some of these people hold masters and doctorates, and yet they say they can't understand the King James or the American Standard. It really says more about their incompetence than it does those versions. Now, I think I'd be kind of ashamed to admit it. I don't want to be cruel about it, but that's just a fact.
Michael Hatcher from Bellevue. Would you comment about this translation? For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved.
That's false. Dead false. Because it is unto, with a view toward, is the force of the preposition.
That's the ESV.
ESV. That's faith only. That's faith only.
David Brown Spring. Comment further about a word-for-word translation, because you know as well as anybody in this room that sometimes you can't have one English word for one Greek word, mm-hmm. or even be able to put words for an expression or something, whatever. Go ahead and comment, because people jump on that. That's yes. impossibility.
They say yeah. it's wooden and so on. Yeah. Well, quite frankly, I've studied a few languages in my lifetime, and we were taught, you're taught in virtually every language class you go to do a word-for-word translation, whether it's Chinese, whether it's French, whether it's German, and so on. Why can't we apply those same basic rules to the translation of God's Word? If I can translate a German phrase literally, then why can't I translate the same basic phrase in Greek literally? And so on. That just doesn't make sense. Yes, there are nuances that a Greek word may have that in a particular context, but then that is the responsibility of the translator to be familiar with that nuance, with the emphasis and so on, the study, to select the English word that closest represents that nuance. The difference is Greek oftentimes used one word that given in a particular context could bear several different uses or nuances. What are called connotative ideas. So many times we forget the fact that in definition you have the denotative meaning. Sometimes we call that the dictionary meaning, the literal meaning, what the word primarily means, and that can change in a language over time so that you now have a denotative meaning that it did not formally have. It becomes the primary meaning. But Greek is a dead language. Ancient Greek is dead language. So everything's pretty much set in concrete now. We have the denotative meanings, and we have the connotative uses. Sometimes we call them the connotative meanings. These are meanings that are affected or created by context. And it's simply a matter of selecting the proper word that best suits that meaning or use in the given context. And the work of the translator is to familiarize himself as much as he possibly can with the habits and practice of that's involved in Greek syntax. Become familiar with it and make use of it in translating it. So sometimes, yes, we do, and that's what the King James does, and yet you have people will criticize the King James because, well, it used so many different words for this one word. Well, that's because context had some effect on it. Same with the American Standard. Those men knew the language. They studied classical and Koine Greek to the point that they could virtually eat, sleep, and drink it. J.W. McGarvey gave his valedictorian address, I understand, in classical Greek. What a difference. What a difference. Is that what you wanted to cover? I know sometimes it can sound wooden, but you know, the duty of the preacher and the duty of the Bible class teacher is to read the law of the Lord distinctly and give the sense of it. Amen. The translator's responsibility is to translate it as accurately and as precisely. And if that sounds a little wooden, tough. We can live with that. We need to know God's Word.
Amen.
Okay.
Dub McClish, Denton, Texas. Denotative means denotes.
It denotes.
Connotative means it connotes.
Yeah.
And that's the distinction of the two.
That's right.
It might be worthwhile to understand the difference between translation and interpretation.
Oh, definitely.
And the modern speech versions interpret instead of translate.
Absolutely.
And another thing that might be worthy of note, in a courtroom, when you have to have translation, they want that just right.
Yes.
Literally. What the witness says is to go on the record. Why should it be not more important with the very Word of God?
Absolutely. Well, following up on that, some of the very ones who write these works, write books and articles attacking the idea of a literal translation, get upset when they are not literally translated and their works are carried over into a language other than the original parent language. That's right. If they write in English and they translate it into German or French, I have quite a few books that were originally written in German or written in French that were translated in English. Well, who did they get to do the translation? Someone who was fluent in the language, who could give a literal rendering of what those languages, the words, properly represented in their context. And his point on the meaning of denote and the meaning of connote. You know, another thing is people need to learn how to read dictionaries. You know, we used to teach that in public school. How do you read a dictionary? A lot of folks don't know anymore. They'll look at a dictionary and they'll say, oh, this word means this here, so it must mean this everywhere. And a pet peeve of mine is Strong's Dictionary. Michael Hatcher and I have discussed it. I think we would do the world a favor if we burned all the Strong's dictionaries, because we have people who are assuming that they understand the defining of terms and what terms mean. When they look at Strong's, and Strong's has like 8 different meanings to a particular word and stuff, and they pick the meaning they want for whatever text they're dealing with and try to force it on that text. And they come up with some of the wackiest, dumbest stuff I've ever seen. Again, you have to pay attention to context. Now, just take the English word hot. The English word hot. What does it mean? Well, it has a denotative meaning that has to do with temperature, high temperature. But it has a whole boatload of other meanings that are highly figurative in nature and can mean stolen. It can mean sexy. It can also be used in some context to reverse, with a reverse meaning. Again, context is important. Do we have anything else along this line?
This is maybe a little hot topic. How do you know 3,000 were baptized on the day of Pentecost?
Because of the proper translation of it, yeah.
How do you know 3,000 were baptized?
Mm-hmm. Because that's what it says.
Read it to me.
Mm-hmm. Huh? About 3,000, yeah.
Now read it to me. Mm-hmm. Well, quote it then. Stop right there. That's how many received his word on that day, and they were baptized. Now what?
And the same day, there were added unto them about 3,000.
Yeah, about 3,000, yeah.
How do you know it says 3,000 were baptized? It says 3,000 were added on that same day.
Because the Lord had to the church that you should be saved, and in order to be saved, you have to be baptized.
What happened to all those people that were baptized into John's baptism? To what were they added?
They
How do you know they weren't added to the apostles?
Well, the apostles were part of it.
Well, the apostles were set in, but the people who were added to it, as far as John's, were baptized for the remission of sins, John, in Mark 1 and 4.
Yeah, John's disciples were set in the church.
Not with him.
No, no.
What I'm trying to simply say is that that gets into language.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And that seems rather simple, and it's something we've used all our life.
Mm-hmm.
But you can see how that you need to think through those words.
You have to reason them.
And it depends upon a whole lot of what's said earlier than that about John's disciples, about the apostles, about what John's baptism was, about those people who were baptized on that day. What about the 120? All of that. Mm-hmm. And that's one reason that when we went into Russia, you could have gotten people to translate for you from English into Russia who were very good translators when it came to business matters. But they didn't know anything about Bible terms.
Mm-hmm. No,
well, now you've introduced another. No, you can't say things like that without giving a background to it. Anyway, you wanted people who had an understanding of the Bible and Bible terms. They could render these things properly when they're translating for you. Now, let me tell you what he's talking about, belly button. This brother was speaking, and he was speaking on apologetics. And he was being that Adam and Eve were created full grown. Thus, there was no gestation period. There was in their mother's womb. So he said, did they actually have a belly button? And Eliel was translating, and he was sitting over here sort of looking like this. And he said, belly button. He goes, belly button? What is belly button? Things like that don't translate too well.
Yeah.
That's another thing translators run into. Those idioms and those things, they will not, they just don't translate. We were sitting in Singapore one time, and the lady was, an American was trying to tell some sort of joke, I don't know what it was, and the Chinese didn't get it because it was one of these things dependent upon an idiom, and the poor lady, American, was going to explain to the Chinese why she didn't get it and what he meant, and she just said, oh, he's pulling your leg. And she looked down in the table. Those things translators have to understand, and it also has to do understanding all that stuff with the translator relative to the idioms and the manners and figures of speech of 2,000 years ago in the Middle East among the Jews. All that makes all the world a difference.
And some of that also enters into the interpretation that follows up to translation. You don't necessarily put it in the translation as such. All right.
I've got to read that.
I'm still Jerry Brewer from Elk City. Some good points you brought out, both of you, really. And you may, that'll be reflected in your grade. But here where it says, that same day they were added unto them about 3,000 souls, unto them is in italics.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It wasn't in the original. So, literally, it says there were added about 3,000 souls. Added to what? Added to the church.
Verse 27.
Yeah.
Or 47, excuse me.
Yeah, added to the church. Even if it says added unto them, then them would be, I came to this conclusion several years ago, John's converts. If you look in Luke 1, he said that the angel told Zacharias that John would make ready people prepared for the Lord. We know, in fact, I think Daniel mentioned prepared people. He prepared them just like David prepared the material, or the material was prepared for the temple. There was no sound heard while it was in building. It was prefabricated. There were no cell phones. It was prefabricated, brought, and set in. And that's in, what is it, 1 Kings 6? But the point, why would it say that? Because God intended to let us know something there, that the material for the spiritual temple of the New Testament was built the same way. John prepared the material. And so, anyway, that's... And I wanted to share, speaking of translation, I want to share something I wrote a few years ago right here in the front of my Bible. While the man... huh? Oh. Yes, ma'am. While the men who translated this book weren't inspired, the words which they wrote, which were translated from the copies of the ancient autographs, were and are inspired. Jesus quoted from a translation, the Septuagint, and placed the stamp of inspiration on it, John 10, 34 and 35. The only valid test of a translation is truth. If it is true, it is valid. If it isn't true, it is a lie, and it isn't the Word of God.
I'm Buddy Roth from Spring. There are four more capable scholars right here in this room than I, but I can't help but observe one thing and make a comment. Aren't we basically saying, be a student?
Most certainly.
Just gather your sources. Be careful.
You're handling God's word.
Right. And gather whatever information from reliable sources, mm-hmm. from people who studied. I put a great deal of value in when David Brown stands up here and teaches a class. I learn from him. He has, on occasion, because I sit right there, he'll look over at me and say, what does the New King James Version say? Because he's already studied and he knows that maybe there's a slightly better word there to be used. And I even keep an interlinear copy right there too, and he'll sometimes ask me about that. So what I'm basically saying is get your sources together, and I'm not above picking up the phone call Daniel Denham or Doug McClish, and to be a student, okay?
Anyone else? All right, we have this question. I've heard and read from various sources that the conversion of the Gentiles, that is Cornelius and his family, that would be Acts 10, happened about 10 years after Pentecost. Question, what evidence do we have for that time reference? Well, it is based on the assumption that the book of Acts is completely chronological in nature. I'm personally of the belief by virtue of two things. First, the prophecy of Daniel chapter 9, verse 24 through 26, relating to the 70 weeks of Daniel, that the conversion of the Gentiles occurred 3.5 years after the death of Christ, that it formed the last half of that 70th week. Christ was to be... cut off in the midst of the week. And the Hebrew word literally means half. So that meant, and that accords with the record we have in the gospel accounts, which gives his ministry of about 3.5 years. That would leave 3.5 more years for the confirming of the covenant. Now, Brother Rex Turner was of the opinion that 3.5 years later, you had the gospel go to Samaritans. That was his position. But if you look at the book of Acts carefully and pay attention to what is referred to in Greek syntax as the temporal markers, basically the adverbs and other terms that are used for dating purpose, sometimes the use of participles and things of that nature in respect to the time of actions in relationship to other action verbs, it is quite possible that much of those first 10 chapters are concurrent. so that you have actions being described by Peter or about Peter, and then actions concerning the apostle, Saul of Tarsus and his conversion and so on, that actually are occurring about the same time. Well, how do you record that without just mixing them together and making a mess of it? Well, you would have to separate the two and then use the temporal markers to give you some idea of the flow of events. And I think that's the answer to it. I would say the conversion of Saul of Tarsus, and before him the gospel going to the Samaritans, and then the events surrounding Peter in various parts of those first 10 chapters, including the conversion of Cornelius and his family, all occurred within a 3.5-year period. And you say, well, that's a lot to happen. Well, think about what happened in the first 3.5 years. And what Jesus did, where he went, how far they traveled, and how many lessons were presented, and in some cases repeated. So it's not far-fetched at all. And it would perfectly accord with the prophecy of Daniel and be a tremendous demonstration from the on the basis of that text for the as an argument for the historicity of early Christianity. Anyway, any comments, questions? Let me see. We've got about 5 minutes. I don't know if I can do justice to this in the time frame. Are the terms miraculous and supernatural synonymous and or interchangeable? They are not synonymous. All miracles are supernatural, but not all supernatural things are miracles. For example, the Bible speaks of God fashioning our spirit within our body. It also speaks of God as the Father of spirits. Now, question. When a baby is conceived, is that baby's spirit, soul, a result of the genetic information only, or is there something that occurs at conception that involves an operation of God that is perfectly in keeping with the natural order? And yet, because it does involve an operation of God, is supernatural in that respect. Miracles by their nature, and here's a word I have used more recently, is contra-natural. That is to say, miracles by their very nature, if you properly define miracles, involve a setting aside or a superseding or a speeding up in some fashion of the operation of natural law. And so it's contra to what is normal operation of those laws. There was a group of people centuries ago who taught that only by natural procreation, that through the seed of the man and the seed of the woman being joined together, that within that was the personality or the seed of the personality of every human being. That at conception, what we would call genetic predisposition, your spirit was formed. This is called traducianism. That has certain problems, certain doctrinal problems and logical problems, because it would entail a predisposition to whatever you are and whatever you would become. Brother Dove.
Dove McClish.
In the very nature of the case, our understanding of providence is supernatural activity, but it is not miraculous.
Absolutely. God's at work, is he not? Yes. What is that? Oh.
Dave and I had breakfast with a couple of brethren that are well known. If I call their names, I don't know any point in calling their names. But they lived east of the Mississippi and not very far east. This was like 10 years ago, 12 years ago. And these brethren were very upset because of information that had been, was being discussed at the time, denying that there was anything supernatural apart from the miraculous. Mm-hmm. The basis of their argument, as I understood it, was that to say that there is a distinction between the miraculous and the supernatural was to give some sort of credence and advantage to MacNeever's arguments on direct operation of the Holy Spirit.
No, simply
which, of course, has nothing to do with it.
Yeah, that's right.
We had a good breakfast. I don't think we convinced.
The a proper definition of terms solves the problem. In the 2011 lectureship that took place here, I addressed in part that very same subject. As part of the title of a lesson, Christ Confronted Error, concerning the miracles, concerning miracles. And I believe, is that lectureship still in print, that book?
2013.
I urge you to get that material. If you don't have the book, get it. If it's out of print, then I hope Amazon has it. It's got a lot of other material in the lecture. There's outstanding lessons on other subjects also, and that is Christ the Great Controversialist. But anything further along that line? Well?
Michael Hamlin tomorrow.
Yes. Does he what? Oh, yeah. He can take over and he can handle the heavy stuff.
Well, we thank you, Brother Daniel, for taking time to do this. Appreciate the involvement of everybody, the questions. One of the things like this, when you do get answers to questions, but sometimes those answers help you understand even other things and make you think about them more. Thinking about God being the Father of our spirits, I think it would do well if every young couple, I mean married, would realize what a responsibility God has placed upon them. When they engage in procreative act, God Almighty creates a soul that will live forever. That within itself says much about the sanctity of life. And people don't think of that way. It's sort of like God wanting every soul to be saved, and it's through the gospel that he saves, but he puts the gospel in the hands of the church to get it into all the world. What a cooperative effort. And when you think about children being born and a soul being created, as God fathers those spirits, that are going to exist somewhere forever. That's an awe-inspiring thing to think about that.